The date is May 31st, 2009. Air France flight 447 left Rio de Janeiro going to Paris. 228 souls were on board. And this airplane was really spectacular in how automatic the plane was, meaning that the pilots could get on takeoff, and then once they cleared the departing airport, they could put on automatic pilot, and the plane more or less did the work, okay? It highly automated. All's well and good. And what happened was the two pilots, they kind of went into a passive mode because, the airplane's going to fly itself. But then there was a minor problem. A minor problem was there's what's called these pitot tubes, and the pitot tubes send speed and air direction to the computers in the plane, and they froze up, which can happen at time from time to time. And what happened was as soon as that froze up, alarms went off and it knocked it off automatic pilot. So all of a sudden, these pilots had to go from a passive way of thinking to a very active way of thinking. And when that happens, we can go into a cognitive trap called cognitive tunneling, where we kind of focus on whichever's right in front of us and maybe overcorrect. Like if you've ever been driving down the street kind of in a passive kind of driving mode, and next thing you know, you're driving through a light and all of a sudden it quickly turns yellow and you snap out of passively driving to actively driving and you overcompensate, you hit your brakes and you kind of jolt your car. Well, that's kind of what happened here. Now, what they did was they started tilting the nose of the airplane up, thinking that would start to compensate it. But that can put a plane into what's called stall, or the lift of the plane started going up, and therefore that put the plane into tremendous jeopardy. And the captains couldn't recover from this lift. They kept trying to figure out what the problem is, but because the pitot tubes were frozen, they couldn't get proper data. What happened was, finally the captain raced to the cockpit and realized what was happening, but it was too late. They could see the waves of the ocean, and the plane crashed, and everybody on board died. And what a tragedy. They didn't know for 2 years what happened until they were able to recover the voice recorder and really see what happened. And all of this was because of cognitive tunneling. Now, when we practice medicine, especially emergency medicine, critical care, when you have someone's life on the line, we have two primary ways of thinking. We have a passive way and an active way. Daniel Kahneman wrote a book called Thinking Fast and Slow. It's an awesome book to help you understand how we think. It's a super hard book to read, and it's more like a textbook, but overall it teaches two major concepts. And this is how I like to bring it to people's attention. I'd like you to think of a submarine and a submarine going through the ocean. And the submarine has to watch out for things around it, so it puts its radar on, and the radar just kind of keeps going, and anything blips on the radar, it can sense it. But the radar is a passive way that a submarine pays attention to its surroundings. If they see a blip on the horizon, then all of a sudden the captain will put up a periscope and focus on exactly what it is. Where the periscope is active, where the radar is passive. Ladies and gentlemen, we think the same way. We have level one and level two thinking, or as Daniel Kahneman talks about it, system one and system two. Where we have radar thinking, that's our body constantly searching the environment. It's our intuitions, it's our gut reactions. So as you're listening to this, I could ask you, do you like the sound of my voice? Yes or no. Is your room cold or warm? Do you like President Trump? You get visceral responses to that. It doesn't take any energy whatsoever, okay? If I asked you, what is 13 times 16? You have to immediately, if you really try to solve that, go into a different level of thinking. You gotta put your periscope up and really focus on the question. Now, the problem is with our brains is we were designed for survival and we're designed to conserve energy. So lazy system one thinking is how we operate most of the time. And that serves us, right? It can make us very efficient. When we come up with these mental shortcuts within system one thinking, we become very efficient. And if you work in emergency medicine, we call those heuristics. Heuristics are mental shortcuts that help us to become very efficient. The problem is when something deviates from a heuristic, a mental shortcut pattern we developed, we have to snap into periscope thinking. We have to focus on the problem very detailed and in a way that makes us take more action. So the purpose of this lecture and this talk is to talk to you about how do we go from changing our focus in medicine, where we go from passive state to an active state. And that has been what I believe is one of my biggest assets as an emergency medicine clinician, is I can walk into a room and look for pattern recognition, whether it's a pulmonary embolism or acute coronary syndrome, or it's, you know, a peptic ulcer or some infectious aseptic patient. We form these mental models in our head and we look for those models. We look for the pattern recognition. But if something's off pattern, we have to stop, focus, reset our thinking and start from scratch. So you have to understand two levels of thinking. One's a passive way of thinking and one's a very active way of thinking. And if you don't understand that, you won't understand that there's got to be a jump when the patterns don't make sense. One of the things I found working hospice medicine in the intensive care unit was a concept that kept coming back time and time again. It was a situation where a nurse would call me and say, "John, can you come up and see Mr. Smith?" And I would say, "Well, what's going on?" "Well, I don't know. Something's not right." I mean, early in my career, I'd say, "Well, what is it? Their vital signs? Is it chief complaint?" And they would say, "John, I don't know what it is, but something's wrong." And I'd go up and see the patient, and lo and behold, the nurse's intuition was so good that that is a highly sensitive test for me to say something's wrong with the patient. If an experienced nurse tells me, "John, come see the patient, something's wrong," there was always something wrong. What they did was they were doing a general assessment, and because they were a seasoned nurse, they had patterns in their brain of what a normal patient should look like. And when they deviated from what a normal patient should look like, they would look at a constellation of symptoms and say, "Something's not right. I want you to come see the patient." Now, that takes time to develop, that intuition. I think it takes about 3 years, and that's my experience in working with a bunch of other clinicians. It takes about 3 years. That's why a lot of residency programs are 3 years, where you get enough patients under your belt to know what normals look like. So I want you to understand the concept and make this a catalyst for your thinking. You have passive and active thinking. Now, what determines your switching from passive to active thinking? And to a huge degree, it's your paradigms. It's how you look at your clinical practice. Okay, too often we get complacent and we stay very passive, and that's when we make mistakes. That's when we don't see slight deviation from pattern recognition and we don't take the next step. I can tell you that as a new graduate, I had this bias towards benign. Well, what do you mean by that, John? I mean that when I saw a patient, in the back of my mind, I'm like, this is okay. This is going to be nothing, okay? And as I got into medicine and I had a couple near misses, I realized, holy cow, a bias towards benign makes me default more into a lazy mode. Now I'm a bias towards bad. I'm a bias towards thinking bad things are going to happen within these patients. So I'm constantly looking for deviations of patterns. I'll never forget, it was a 78-year-old guy who they called me to admit and said, "John, can you put this guy in for chest pain?" And I went and saw the guy and absolutely had some kind of acute event happen with his wife during dinner. He had this significant onset of chest pain. He became diaphoretic. They came to the ER, had a normal workup, and we were going to admit him for rule out acute coronary syndrome. He had a nonspecific EKG, normal troponins, normal biomarkers. And I remember going to see him, and I'm looking at him, and I saw a whole bunch of acute coronary syndrome at this point. I had a really clear pattern of what an acute coronary syndrome patient looks like. But I got into the habit of always documenting what did they do in the ER for the patient, like what medications did they give. And I remember exactly where I wrote it. It was in the back page of my history and physical, right up at the top left. And I realized they had to give him a liter of fluid in the ED. And as I looked at the notes, it was because of blood pressure support. And I realized this guy was borderline hypotensive. Pressures were in the 90s. And I remember going into him saying, "Sir, how's your pressure normally?" He goes, "It's 120 over 80. I check it all the time." And I'm going, that doesn't make sense, because he had no ongoing pain. And if he had an acute coronary syndrome that made him hypotensive, he'd look pretty sick. That's cardiogenic shock. And he's not in cardiogenic shock. And I'm like, that's just weird. And on his physical exam, he had some rales in his left base, almost sounding like pneumonia, but he didn't have a fever, didn't have a white count. That didn't look like pneumonia to me. And I'm like, this just doesn't seem to fit my acute coronary syndrome pattern. And then I went and looked at the chest x-ray, and, you know, portable chest x-rays always have a widened appearing mediastinum. So it's a really bad screening test, but it looked wide to me. And I'm like, this just doesn't fit the pattern of acute coronary syndrome. So I remember talking to Linda, the night nurse, and I said, "Listen, Linda, I want to scan this guy. I want to do a CAT scan of his chest. Something's not right." And I was about a three-year PA at this time, and Linda was a wonderful charge nurse, but when you had to scan somebody at night, she was the one who had to push him, and it was another building. It was a real hassle to get a CAT scan. And I felt guilty about it. I felt like, oh man, I'm making too much of this. So I'm like, "Linda, I'll help you push the patient over." So we pushed the patient over. I had to leave. I got to go back to the ER for another admission. And I'm down in the ER, and half an hour later, I get the phone call. And it was a radiologist. John, the radiologist on the phone. I get the radiologist on the phone. He says, John, that guy's got a type 1 thoracic dissection. And I was like, it was because things didn't make sense, okay? So ladies and gentlemen, you have to learn to control your focus. Are you in a passive mode or an active mode? And how can I best help you with that? How can I best help you know when to change your focus? Well, the bottom line is you have to form mental models in your brain of what a normal patient looks like. So if I said to you, what does a pediatric patient with moderate respiratory distress look like? Can you picture it in your brain? If you don't know exactly what that looks like and the clinical ramifications of that, you have to YouTube it right now. Stop this learning and go look at what moderate respiratory distress looks in a kid so you'll know it when you see it. You have to have mental models of what does a normal patient look like and what does that N patient look like. So a soft chest pain you're gonna send home, what does that patient look like and how are you gonna document it, okay? You can't stay in passive mode, and please don't misunderstand me. There are times that I go see a patient and my mind is very passive. I'm constantly looking for when can I pop out of passive to active mode thinking. It is unrealistic to think that people are going to stay in level 2 thinking their whole time. They'd be absolutely exhausted at the end of the shift because the body is designed to conserve energy. The mind is designed to conserve energy. So there are times you need to be passive and there's times you need to be very active. What makes a really good clinician is knowing when to make that shift. So the best way I can help you to understand how to make that shift is just be aware of it. Be aware that you have to go from passive to active thinking. And when a nurse brings you new information or a patient brings you new information, that's a time that you have to go into active mode. Now, I can tell you from experience, when you go to work working in an emergency room, especially a busy emergency room, you need to be sharp. You need to be sharp. And that means you have to be optimal when you go in. Meaning that your biochemistry has got to be as good as can be, meaning you got a good sleep, hydration, you got to be recharged. If you have an emotional burden at home, that will change how you think, okay? Because if you have a big burden at home with your wife or your kids, you're going to have more of your passive, lazy mind focusing on it than your patient. So you really want to go to work as healthy and optimal as you can. And that's where pattern recognition is very important. That's when mnemonics and checkoff sheets are very important to make you efficient. When a pilot gets on an airplane, they do a checklist every single time. So when you're working up someone with chest pain or shortness of breath or abdominal pain, you need to have cognitive checklists so you don't get burned. Folks, my hope is this talk has been helpful to you to give you a catalyst for thinking. A really, really good clinician is always looking at their performance. And I have found in medicine, it's easy to make technical advances. It's hard to make paradigm changes. And thinking about your thinking is metacognition. That's what will give you the most optimal growth is when you think about your thinking and think on your next shift. Am I in a passive thinking mode or an active thinking mode? And what's gonna snap you out of a passive thinking mode? Okay, like if you see someone with a respiratory rate of 26 on the nurse's triage sheet, that better snap you out of it. It's an adult because that's not normal. Okay, so I'm going to challenge you to be focused on that in your next shift. Are you in a passive or active thinking mode? Are you critically thinking? John Belinsky from See Me for Life, the Emerging Medicine Institute. Our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. My hope is that you hear this. You work to apply it, but more importantly, you teach it to others. Good luck and God bless.